Last time when we were here, I thought I would not come back again. Because the journey is very far and tiresome. And the means of transportation is not all that good. I don't like the brains. But I'm thankful to our God because he has made it. And we are here together with my husband. And we are very happy to see you. And also I want to thank your pastor and his wife. They have been our friends. And I know that the Lord is going to bless you and write you and do more things in your church. Amen? Amen. So when we were coming, we were given greetings and received them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And before I sit down, I want to sing a song for you.
Yes.
We speak four languages, and the song I'm going to sing for you, it has many languages, and I believe that the Lord is going to bless you. The song is about the house of the Lord. It is saying that in the house of the Lord, there are so many blessings, there are so many things. You see, when you are outside, there are so many things that can happen, but when you come in the house of the Lord, there are blessings, encouragement, and the power of God. Amen?
Amen.
So may the Lord God bless you and do you good. So I'm going to sing the song, and I believe my husband is going to help me.
I will help you.
Yeah. There is something today in the house of the Lord. There is something today.
Because your church and your administration
has been of great help, even putting everything together, especially the support that you send every month, has been greatly helping the ministry, Destiny Community Church, to continue. And we always work with you. And we always receive the offering that is given from this church. And it has been a great help to our ministry back there in Kenya. Amen. For the last 1 year, since I was here last year, we have seen growth and a lot of things going forward, developments in the church. We have seen God put us to the next level in the churches over there. And for now, we have expanded. We are not the same way we started. In fact, Destiny Community Church started the day, the year we came to visit you when you used to be in Tuolomi Road. And we miraculously got connected with the pastor. And we listened just to hear what the Lord is doing in your church. 5 years ago, together with our sister Martha, I saw her this morning. And we connected with the pastor. And since then, we have become great friends. Not only ministers together, but friends. Amen. Amen. And we are friends with several of you in this church. When we come here, we feel like we have come to fellowship with the rest of the family that is in California. Amen. Amen. Destiny Community Church, we have really grown. Last year, we got one of your teams over. I was with John Houston for 2 weeks. I was with the team from Cowboy Church for 2 weeks. A team of 19 people came over, and in fact, we feel like Sonora is becoming our next village. Amen. So we have grown and expanded from the day we got to know Harvest Fellowship Church. And Pastor Kim has been very helpful and supportive to writing us a letter of invitation that you can never come to America without a church ministry writing you a letter to the Embassy of Kenya and tell them we would love him to come again. Amen. And Pastor Kim has been doing that, and we appreciate very much as the Destiny Community Church. We are 15 churches in Kenya, and the churches are always growing. We have challenges, and a lot of them, but we are seeing God lift us through the challenges altogether. Amen. Amen. Life is full of challenges, and we have to accept them, and we have to move on, because God grows us in the midst of challenges. Amen. And right now we are starting a school, a kindergarten and a grade school that is going to start in 2018 January, when school starts in Kenya. And we are here raising some funds to be able to sponsor the orphans and the vulnerable children who cannot be able to go to school in the village of them where we come from. And we have already started the plan, and we are believing God for January 2018 to have a school going on. We have bought property. Your church helped us, together with several others, to consolidate the fund to buy the property for the school, and the property is already bought. I believe on Wednesday, when my wife will be speaking, we will put together some pictures for you to see on the screen, and then you will be able to see how far the Lord has taken Destiny Community Church for the last 1 year. And thank you very much. Be praying for Kenya. We are at the electioneering period, we have a lot of things going on in Kenya. Election was done on 8th August, but the Supreme Court nullified the results and made them void. So we are starting an election again within 60 days, which is very intense, which is very aggressive, and on the 17th of October, that is when we are electing our president. Only for the president he was nullified, but the Senate and the Assembly, House Assembly, was still okay. So we are praying for Kenya and the elections to go smoothly, and not want our country to fall and become useless, which can be very dangerous for all of us. Amen. Let's pray for Kenya always, and remember us, and remember the Destiny Community Church. Thank you very much again. For those who are on Facebook, I know you always see what we are doing in Kenya, and you see our pictures and everything on the Facebook. My name is Richard Murungi, or Bishop Richard Murungi, and that's the name on the Facebook. If you want to look for me, and God will bless you, you can see all what we are doing, and you'll be blessed. Amen?
Amen.
If you want to get my email, I have some cards outside. You can go to the desk and pick my card, and you can search for us and see what we are doing in Kenya. Our Facebook is designed like a website for our international community, because we don't have all that strength to work on the website. Amen? God bless you. And now I want to take you to the Word of God. When I was coming from Kenya, the Lord has been putting this word on my mind, and it has become so clear in me that God wants to minister to you this morning through the book of Exodus chapter 17, verses 8 to verses 16. If you put that scripture or that verse of the Bible, you will see that God allowed this to happen to the children of Israel when they were coming out of Egypt. And in the book of Exodus chapter 8, chapter 17, verses 8, we will read it together, and you can see it on the screen. And I did that intentionally so that you can capture my accent. And as you read there, you can hear and learn my accent, and then we'll flow together. Amen? The Bible says, "Then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us and come out men, and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand." So Joshua did as Moses and said to him, and he fought with Amalek, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. Verse 11. And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy. And they took a stone and put it under him. And he sat thereon, and Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, the one on the one side and the other on the other side. And his hands were stayed until the went down of the sun. And Joshua discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. And the Lord said unto Moses, write this for a memorial in a book and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua, for I will actually put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. Verse 15. And Moses brought an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi. For he said, because the Lord has sworn that the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. Amen. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I bless your word this morning. I pray that you minister to your people under your power and Lord Almighty, enablement from above. Lord Almighty, let's you minister to each one individually. Unless your word have a place in the life of your church this morning. In Jesus' name, I pray and bless you. Amen. I want to share with you about the battles of life. This life is a battlefield. And many of us have been fighting every time of their life. And maybe you are exhausted, you are frustrated, you are feeling disappointed about all what is going on in your life and going on in your family or marriage or in your business. Battles after battles. Every time, every year, every week, every season. Things happening, things coming, things going. And in the book of Exodus chapter 17, verse 8 to verse 16, we see that even Job, even Moses, when he was in the ministry of deliverance, still he had battles that he was fighting. He was fighting battles after battles. And these battles were challenging. I want to share with you on my introduction about these battles. And one thing you need to know as a Christian and as a believer or as a leader in the ministry is that life is a battleground. Life is a battleground. And because life is a battleground, we need to know that we have to continue. Some people describe life as a battleground. You have to fight to survive. Starting from the day a baby is born, he has to fight the unfriendly environment the world has to offer. You have to fight the challenges, all kinds of germs and diseases in this world. Taking so many shots just to protect them from harm that he will grow up healthy. And by the time the baby is old, enough to go to daycare or to school, he needs to fight for attention of the workers or the peers. Then in grade school, he has to fight for acceptance and for grades, peer pressure, favor of the teachers. And then when he goes to college, there's a young man, he starts to fight for in the job market, finding dates and many more hurdles he has to overcome just to survive. And if he's lucky, he may make it to something somehow. Life begins like a fight. And we have to know that winning the battles of life, you have to have the understanding that you are in the battle. When we started the ministry in Kenya, we thought that everything was to go smoothly and there would be no fights, there would be no challenges. But we have seen that in the ministry, in the kingdom of God, life is about winning and fighting for the position that the Lord has given. And this one, we see that whenever we fight well, whenever we win according to the way God wants us to do, we always go to the next level and we always become more mature and more stronger than we were before. Number two thing I would like you to know as a church or as a believer, spiritual growth is also a battle to win. You have to win in your spiritual growth. As a Christian, when you begin, the same happens to you. Ever since the great fall of men have to fight to resist the corrupted nature, temptations from the inside and the out, crossing the rivers of evil, all over, climbing mountains of human deficiency, and constantly fight the spiritual war against the devil every day of your life. No one nation. We are all born with a lot of weaknesses, a lot of faults, and we have to fight to become better. We have to fight to move on. Amen?
Amen.
Life is, the expression broad is a battle. We can remain babies forever if we do not work and fight for it. We need to mature. That's what the Lord wants us to be. And that's why you let battles come over your life. That's why he lets battles come over your marriage. That's why he lets wars come over your life. We have to move forward. And number three, we see it in the Exodus journey of the children of Israel. The history of the Exodus of the Israelites is a journey of our people of God. They need to travel. We may learn important lessons from that part of history, both on individual and the corporate level. The struggles and the setbacks, battles, and the victories of the ancient Israel are the same as for modern day Christians, you and me. It's the same. We are all fighting. Though the Exodus was commanded by God, the journey was never a smooth one. It was still having challenges. The battle against the Amalekites, as recorded in this chapter 17 in Exodus, is a great story for us to learn some of the lessons and the techniques on how to win over the battles of life, both in this world and the spiritual level. God told Moses to write it in down as you have heard, and make sure it is mentioned to Joshua, the captain, the leader of the people, who goes to fight with the sword, so that he can be encouraged that battles will be there, that challenges will come, but the man of God should believe on winning, should believe on moving on, not quitting. Praise the Lord. And if you read this Exodus 17:8-16 as we have done, you see that the first thing you have to do as a Christian, know the battles you will fight. You have to know the battles you are fighting. We are not called to fight every battle. In the ministry, there are battles that I do not fight. Sometimes battles will come, and if this battle is not going to to add any value to the kingdom of God, you don't fight it.
Amen.
You have to choose your battles.
Amen.
Knowing our enemy and their schemes may help us strategize our defense better and winning more battles. You have to know your enemy. You know what the devil wants you to do? Is that you should think everything is okay and there are no challenges. He wants you to be comfortable. The enemy wants you to be comfortable and to stay in your comfort zones and not think that anything is gonna happen. But God wants you to know your enemy, and he wants you to know the schemes that he is using so that you can strategize your defense, and you can be able to win more battles. The purpose of fighting, or the reason why God allows challenges, is not that you may be defeated. It's not for you to be dragged. It is for you to move forward. God wants you to move forward, and he wants to take you to the next level. He wants to take you to the next position of your life and anointing. You have great anointing, and that anointing has levels. God wants to take you to that next level. Amen?
Yes.
Here are some of the facts and the strategies we need to know. And this will help us to be able to fight better the battles of our life. I know if you have no battle you are fighting right now, one is going to come soon. If you have battles that you have lost, I know from this one today, be able to know how to fight it again.
Amen.
Number one thing you need to know are facts and strategies you need to know. Number one, there is more than one enemy. Fighting once and winning is not enough. Many people, after they win their battles, they relax, and then the enemy comes like a flood and they drop them down. The Bible says when the enemy will come like a flood, the Lord will lift the standard.
Amen.
You will not be overwhelmed. You will not be overcome. And I want to prophesy in the name of Jesus. There are some of you here who are going through the battles in their life, and God is going to bring you over successfully.
Amen.
You are not going to be defeated.
Come on.
You are not collapsing. You are not closing that business. You are not going to dissolve that marriage, because God is going to do something special in your life today. There are more than one battle that you are, more than one enemy you need to know about it. From leaving Egypt to arriving in Canaan, the Israelites have encountered more than one enemy. Count all the enemies they met. Before they arrived to Canaan, they had met several enemies. They met the Philistines. They met the Amalekites. They met the Amorites. They met the Moabites. They met the king of Hob. They met all those other people. They met the Red Sea as a stumbling block. They met the River Jordan that was flooded. They met. Mention all of them. You are not an exception.
Right.
You are going to encounter all of them. Right. They are going to come. But you shall be able to win, because you are on the winning side.
Amen.
God is going to give you the victory, because He is on your side. He said, He who is on our side is greater than him who is in the world.
Amen.
If we are on the winning side, we don't have to fear. We don't have to worry. We don't have to walk in the kind of a frustration, because our God is going to fix it.
Amen.
Amen. You have to know your enemies. Amalekites were just one of the many enemies Israel encountered in their journey to the promised land. Other enemies such as the Philistines, Edomites, Amorites, the Midianites, all were also eager to make their life miserable. The purpose of the enemy is not to favor you. The enemy will never give you any chance. He is there to destroy you. The enemy is there to destroy your relationship, to destroy your marriage, to destroy your children, to destroy your business. And you have to know that He is not on your side, but God is going to bless you.
Yeah.
No one could assume that life will be peaceful if you do your part right. The same happens to real life today. Challenges and hurdles are a part of everyday life. Problems and difficulties are accompanies of every human being. Don't be surprised by the number of enemies or battles you may have at one time or another. Maybe this year has been the year of a lot of battles and challenges in your life. Don't be surprised. Don't think that you are not praying more better. It's time for you to rise up and to speak victory.
Amen.
It's time for you to pray more. It's time for you to wear, to put on the armor of God more than ever before.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. When you put on the armor of God in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, put on the helmet, put on the breastplate, put on the shoes, put on the belt of truth. All these things to fight better. And we pray without ceasing.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. You see things that are happening in Florida, the hurricanes, floodings, earthquakes, all these challenges we are hearing from our neighbor, foreign elections like in Kenya, and all these other challenges. We need to know that God for him right now.
Amen.
Amen. Don't be surprised. Number two, battles and enemies need no invitation. There is no invitation that they will make. Number three, plans what battles he has to fight. Nobody knows when the battles will begin or when it happens, when the enemy will attack. Battles and enemies need no invitation. They will come to you anytime and anywhere they choose to without warning. Just read Exodus 17 verse 1. The Bible says, while the Israelites were traveling peacefully, mark the word peacefully. When your marriage is so peaceful, when your business was so peaceful, when everything was peaceful, the Bible says, finding their way out of the land of oppression and slavery, the Amalekites decided to come and attack them. They came to attack them without warning or reason. There was no reason. You don't have to do anything wrong. Don't have to provoke anyone to anger. You don't have to be blamed of anything. Problems, betrayal, criticism, let down and unfair treatments will find their way to you. That is life and we can do nothing about it. They always come. They always happen. They will blame you. You will be betrayed. You will be criticized. You will be let down. You will receive unfair treatment after doing good work to people. You don't have to do anything. And that is life, and we can do nothing about it. Praise the Lord. We don't invite the challenges we get. Then what should a man of God do? What should a man of God do? Should they say, I'm not going to church today, I'll stay at home? Should you have anger and resentment in yourself and say, I will never trust God again? No. You have to win your battles.
Amen.
You have to win. Your mentality must be tuned to winning, not losing.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Because when you have God, you will win. And God wants you to win. Moses was one of the great men in the Bible, and he knew that the strategy that he has is only to win, he has to go to the mountain. This is the time. Do you have challenges? Are there people criticizing you? Are you being ridiculed and let down? It's the time to go to the mountain. This is not the time to go down to the valley. And this, on the mountain, you need some people around you. You need some help, heart and the arrow to hold your hands. Because your help comes from above. Come from Jesus.
Amen.
Not from men, from God. Amen?
Amen?
Number three, battles come in many forms. Not even in one. You can't expect, it doesn't come the way you expected it. It doesn't happen the way you thought it would come. Physical battles may be brutal, but they are easy to recognize and fight. Battles from outside are easier to be identified, but they are enemies and battles you never imagined they will come, but they do. I don't mean you need to be suspicious of all the people around you. What I'm trying to say is do not be surprised if one of your friends turns out to be your fearful enemy someday. Praise the Lord. People whom you trust the most might one day lift a seal against you as David and lamented. In Psalms 41 verse 9, there are also battles of the flesh. So there will come a time when even friends will leave you. I had worked in Kenya, I had worked with one of my best friends. And we have done business together, we have ministered listened together for a time, trusted each other with everything. And one time, one morning, he came and told me, after I had supported him and lifted him to the next level, he told me, now I want to become a bishop of my home. And I want to leave you. And I'm not only leaving you, I'm going faster with the other members that I've been working with. And that was very challenging to me because he was my right-hand man. So what did I do? I told him, I will let you go. I will let you go. I don't have to fight with you. I don't have to take over anything from you. I had bought him everything. I bought all the musical instruments, all the things for the church. We had brought everything. We had invested there expecting that this would be our work for a long time. But he told me, I'm taking it with me. I had nothing to do. It happens to me, he was my closest friend. And the people I thought they were not my friends, they are the ones, or the people who are not very close to me, they are the ones who are very good to me. I thought he was my best, but he quitted. Praise the Lord. There are times when your greatest, your dear friend will let you down. There are times when you will be hurt by the people you expected less to hurt you. But what did you do? Are you going to bless them? Are you going to be still serving and loving God for them? God would want to see you rise up above those challenges. They are expected and they will come. And the challenges will come in different forms. They will come the way they want. Even battles of the flesh, the evil nature of man, battles of the heart, the greed, and the hatred, and the thoughts that we have, the bad thoughts, battles of the world, temptations, worldly values, and pleasure seeking. We are constantly at war and battles against the devil, the world, and our corrupted nature. How can we win these battles? Very quickly, I want to share with you the winning strategy of a man of God. How a man of God should behave and how a man of God should look at those battles when they come. And we shall put it in the light of Exodus chapter 17, verse 9 to 12. And number one, don't run, face the enemy challenge. Exodus 17 verse 9a. Don't run. Face the enemy. Most of the time, we like to overlook and run away from the challenge. Another man told me in Kenya, just before I came, he told me, Pastor, the reason why I come home late is because I don't want to meet these challenges at my house. My wife has become dangerous. And I have to stay for a long time and find them asleep. So I told him, this is not the best way to handle your challenges. You have to face it. Praise the Lord. He did not want to go home early so that he can find everybody sleeping and tired, not confront each other. And this will never help. Don't run from your challenges. When the children of Israel found the fight, even though they were untrained, even though they were slaves, a bunch of slaves from Egypt, men and women who have never fought another battle in their lifetime, even their grandparents and their parents have never fought anywhere, they never ran away. They just confronted the enemy. Moses told Joshua, go down with the warriors and the fight. And I will go on the top of the hill together with Moses, Aaron and Hur. And they fought it. In the face of a battle, Moses took his ground and prepared for the war. He gave order to Joshua to select some of the men to fight. Not everybody can do this. Sometimes you have to have some prayer team, selected prayer team. It involves some people in your challenge, not everybody, selectively. Know who to be your prayer partner. Some of your prayer partners turn to become gossip partners. They turn to become men and women to criticize you. Get people who are going to really pray with you. People who will hold you and stand with you in your crisis time. Many people will want to stand with you during when you are celebrating and when things are wonderful. But when things are not working good, some will forget your phone numbers. They'll forget your email. They'll forget whether you exist. They'll say that they'll become busy for you. Because you are in crisis times, select a team that can pray with you and stand with you. And we see here that when Moses chose the team, it worked better. They got this answer, and whenever they got him, he won. Whenever he became tired and did not lift up his hand to heaven, they lost. So they helped him to lift up his hands.
Amen.
There are men and women around you who can stand with you.
Amen.
Don't stand alone. Don't think that everybody is against you. Some people, somewhere, are going to stand with you.
Amen.
There was a time Elijah told God, I'm alone and I want to die. All the prophets have been killed. God told them, no, I have some more prophets remaining. They are around you. Praise the Lord. Stand with somebody. Don't let your brother or your sister alone. They need you. We need each other. We need to continue to support each other. We cannot win our battles without you. You cannot win your battles without them. You need them. Praise the Lord. Once you run, troubles and problems will follow you until you collapse and surrender. They will not let you go. The same is to face temptations and attack by Satan. We need to take the stand and the fight back, and the devil will run.
Amen.
James chapter 4 verse 7 says, resist the devil and he will flee away from you.
Amen.
Resist. Resistance means add some resistance. Just resist him. Don't let him fight forever. Number two, go to battles with God on your side. Don't ever try to fight alone without God.
Amen.
Is God on your side? Is God backing you up? Moses told God, if you are not going, I will not go. That should be our language as Christians.
Right.
Why are you running ahead of God? Why are you trying things that God has not spoken to you? Why are you trying to a strategy that is not from heaven? God wants you to do it together with him.
Amen.
Even in the man of God, David, he told God in the book of 2 Samuel chapter 30. He told God, God, if I pursue them, will I overtake them? If I run over them, will I be able to recover out? Will I be able to bring back my stolen wife and my stolen property? Will I be able? Then God told him, go, and you will get it.
Yes.
The army told him, we are not going. They divide, they split into two. They said, we are not going. Some 200 said, we are not going. And the other 200 out of 400 said, we are going. And the ones who went, because the Lord was on their side, they won.
Amen.
You are going to win when the Lord is on your side.
Yes.
It doesn't matter the season. It doesn't matter whether you don't have enough money. It doesn't matter whether you have no energy or power. God on your side is everything.
Amen.
Go to battles with God on your side. When the army of Pharaoh pursued the people of Israel on the banks of the Red Sea, God asked Moses to stand on the top of the hill and lift up his staff As Moses did what God had told him, the Red Sea was parted and the people crossed over. Number three, never fight battles alone. Never fight battles alone. Don't fight alone. In Exodus chapter 17 verse 10, Moses did not fight the battle all by himself. He had good people around him. Joshua, the general, Aaron, and all his faithful supporters. Joshua led the people fighting, and then Moses was there with Aaron praying. We need a prayer partner, whom you can call and tell him my marriage is in danger. Whom you can call and tell him, I'm overcome by anger, and I need someone to help me. My anger is too much. I need someone to pray with me, because this is a thing I need deliverance. I don't want to do what I do. Most of the people, when they burst in anger, especially in Kenya, good people I know and I respect, they do something that they don't like. They do something they don't love to do. Because anger did it. It was not him. And it's a thing we need to overcome. Amen. It's a thing we need to surrender to God. And then God will get it out of us. Amen? Amen. We need to overcome anger. We have to overcome frustration, resentment, and also all these kind of things that bring us down and we don't walk the walk that God has called us to do. Never fight battles alone. You have a lot of great men, warriors, and women around you who can help you fight your battles. Let them pray with you. I always bless God because in Africa, the ministry we are doing, Destiny Community Church, is supported with a lot of prayers all over the world. We have a lot of friends from everywhere and we tell them, please pray for us. And because of the prayers, we know that's why we are moving forward. Amen. That's why everything can go forward in Africa. Because in Africa, we like when we had guests come over, it was so dusty in June. Every time we see dust blowing everywhere, cars don't look beautiful as you think. As you can see outside, your cars are very beautiful on the parking lot. I don't know whether you all went to the car wash yesterday or this morning, but in Africa they are covered with dust at the parking. Because the place is dusty. Beautiful churches. So we have to fight. We have to fight every day to be able to see the kingdom of God stand and to see everything go on well. Why should we not let God fight with us? Why should we not involve other people to fight with us? Amen? Amen. Number four, seek and welcome support from other people. Seek. Because many times we feel like it's only us, it's me only. We let people know what is going through in our life when it can never be held anymore. When it blows out, that's the time we want people to know. But when things are good, are cooking inside at the primary levels, you don't want anybody to know what's happening. You just want people to know your marriage is on fire. When the fire can never be quenched. When the fire can never be stopped. You want people to know that the day is not right when everything is already toward the head. It's almost uncontrollable. We need to seek and welcome support from other people. No one is so invincible. Not even Moses in the Bible. There will be times you will feel weak like Moses did. Be humble and graciously accept assistance from people around you, especially those on God's side. Amen. It is never shameful to ask and receive help from friends. Fighting the battle all by yourself and getting defeated is not good. On the other hand, be an ally to somebody. Be an help to somebody. Your friends, when they are meet in fighting battles, be there. Let them support. And by the use, by the use of whatever resource is available, such as the rock, so Moses could sit, hold their hands and lift them their heads high when they are feeling weak. Be a king to someone and win the battle. And I will finish by saying this. After you have won, after you have fought your battles and won, continue to walk to God. Don't leave, don't quit. Remember, you will have more battles after this one. You will need God down the road. Never feel independent from God. Too often people forget God after they have won battles. A broken relationship was restored. I recover from a serious sickness, found a long-awaited job, turn around failing business, and then you say, oh, this is enough. God did it for me. Have a testimony. And you forget that another time, another battle might come and is coming. You have to stay, to continue to walk to God. Number two, tell others what God has done. Give them a testimony. Share with the people what God has done. It will help them fight their own battles. Don't keep it to yourself. God asked Moses to write the story down and read it to Joshua. And when he shared, it became a testimony of victory. Amen. God wants us to share. And the last one, being devoted and dedicated to God. Devote yourself and dedicate your life to God. Dedicate your marriage to God. Dedicate the work of your hands to God. Dedicate your children to God. Dedicate your business to God. Because when you dedicate these things to God, God will bless them. Don't say, this is the work of my hands. This is the dream of my training and my expertise. This is what I was trained for. Dedicated to the Lord. Amen. Dedicate your degrees and your diplomas and your certificates to the Lord. There are many who have them and they don't help at all. They are not using them. Dedicated to the Lord. Amen. When you dedicate yourself to the Lord, things will be okay. Be prepared for battles. Seeking God. And let him help you. And have Jesus as the commander in chief of your life. When Jesus becomes the commander, when you put your life to him, he will always bless you. Are you fighting some battles this morning? Are you going through challenges? Know that God is going to cause you to win. You are not a loser. You are not forgotten. You are not the only one. It is life, and we have to go through. God lets men and women go through this life, and he wants them to go out victoriously.
Amen.
That's why the Bible says that when we go to heaven, angels will have to celebrate us. Angels will parade and celebrate us. Why? Because we are conquerors.
Amen.
Because we are winners. We made it because of fighting and winning. Praise the Lord. A believer and a child of God is a conqueror, is a winner, is an overcomer.
Amen.
And because we are all overcomers, angels will celebrate us. We will sing and praise for us because of what God has done through us in the life here on earth. Amen.
Amen.
How are you spending your life? How are you spending your life with the challenges you go through in your marriage? Are you still holding together? Can you be able to hold hands together and pray with your wife or your husband anymore? Can you be able to talk things together anymore? Are you being overwhelmed? God wants you to overcome those hindrances and move on. For you are going to be a winner. God is going to take you through the challenge. And it is very temporary. You are not going to be there forever.
Yes.
Something is going to come and take you over. It's a wind blowing and it will be over.
Right.
It's a season and it will pass. Because seasons come and seasons go.
Yes.
Do not be overwhelmed. Do not let your decisions and your dream cut off, because God is going to bless you.
Amen.
Amen. God is going to bless you. And you will see it, for He loves you. Amen.
Amen.
I know there are people here who have been fighting, and you are almost ready to lose your battles. You are almost thinking that the Lord did not want you to go through all that. That's what Israel thought. When they were in the wilderness, they thought that God is against them. Some of them preferred Egypt, but God moved them anyway, and they overcame. God is going to take you over. Don't be complaining. Don't murmur. Do not let the enemy have a chance, but go on with your life. Let us stand up together and pray. Hallelujah. For us to win our battles, it takes God. For you to be able to move on, it takes God. It doesn't require a secular counselor. It doesn't require taking an action of defeat. It doesn't require you separating with your endurance. It requires you to take the position of God. It requires you to go to the mountain like Moses. And there, let God fight your battles. Jesus is the commander in chief of our battles. He is in charge. And He will take care of you. I want you to go before the Lord this morning. And maybe you are going through something. You have a burden you are carrying on your shoulder. Maybe it's a burden of your marriage or your children. They have gone through drugs or other things. Maybe it's about your community. Just lift up your hand and give it to the Lord. Give all what you are going through to the Lord right now, and then just put it on the foot of the cross. Tell God, God, carry for me. Do not carry those baggages by yourself. God wants to carry it for you. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I pray, Lord Almighty, that You may give us a winning mentality. King of glory, in the midst of all battles, challenges, disappointments, letting downs, and all the challenges we go through, Lord, how I pray that You may give us a positive mind that You gave to Moses. Even Lord Almighty, know that in the top of the mountain, Lord Almighty, that is where the battles will be won. Lord Almighty was able to see You in those challenges. King of glory, I pray for every family represented here. I pray, Lord, for their relationships. I pray, Lord Almighty, for every area that they need check in their life. Lord Almighty, minister to them. Lord Almighty, let You strengthen them. God Almighty, help them to know they are not alone. And God, You are going to fight for them. Help them to know that You are going to handle their challenges, Lord. And God, let them know that King of glory, that You are praying for them and You want them to win. Lord Almighty, let them win their battles. Let them, Lord Almighty, know that the challenges are temporary and they are not permanent. They don't determine their future. God Almighty, let You bless us today. And in the name of Jesus, Lord Almighty, I command blessings upon them. I command healing upon them. I command victory upon them. Right now, I break every spirit of heaviness in the name of Jesus. Lord Almighty, no heaviness. I rebuke the spirit of heaviness right now. In the name of Jesus, the spirit of bitterness, Lord Almighty, let it be broken. In the name of Jesus. King of glory, break it now. For we surrender before You, Jehovah. We shall not surrender before our enemy. We shall not, Lord Almighty, give them our back. We are not, Lord Almighty, turn back. In the name of Jesus, we shall fight the hand king of glory. For you are the Lord of our warfare. I thank you today because of everyone. Thank you today, Lord Almighty, because of that man and that husband. God Almighty, let you strengthen them. God Almighty, let you help them. God Almighty, bless them. For those children, King of Glory, fight for them in the name of Jesus. Fight for them in the name of Jesus. Lord Almighty, shower them with the blessings of the kingdom. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen.